you know anything about the market for cigars in the 1980s, it's that consumer perspectives were slowly shifting to a much more negative view on the product. In decades prior, cigars were seen as, and thus marketed as, classy, social, and attractive items, and while some of that still does hold today, the average person doesn't see the cigarette in the light they once did. As a result of shifting consumer tastes due to anti-smoking lobbyists capturing the public's attention with ad and research campaigns, the smoking giant RJ Reynolds, the ones behind the Camel and Winston cigarettes, would try a new strategy to boost sales amid a controversial market by releasing the world's very first smokeless cigarette. A strange little product that was not only unfavorable, but would go on to become a complete failure. In 1988, RJ Reynolds would spend a whopping $325 million developing a product known as the Premier Smokeless Cigarette. Smokeless Cigarette did exactly what it said it did, gave the smoker a smokeless experience. There were issues right off the bat, with the taste apparently being awful. It was so bad, in fact, that the company's chief executive officer said, quote,
"They all said they tasted like
Furthermore, the pack of squares was hard to use, requiring a practical iron lung to inhale. Reporter magazine jokingly wrote at the time that in order to light it, you'd need a blowtorch, and that the smell it produced once lit left the user barfing. The product's reputation just kept getting beaten down when a rumor started spreading around that dealers were allegedly using the product to hide cocaine, which was a growing issue at that time across the US. The problems didn't let up. Around its release, the American Cancer Society would call for the cigarette to be regulated as a drug by the FDA, out of fear that teenagers would begin to be attracted to its smokeless nature. In fact, speaking of the FDA, the administration's guidelines state that any product marketed as healthy and safe must be regulated, something RGR completely ignored. They didn't just ignore it, however, they actually found a loophole around it. They marketed the product as a cleaner instead of safer version of cigarettes, which might not seem like a big difference, but in the world of legal lingo, it was perfectly fine. When it came to RJ Reynolds' customers, though, the same couldn't be said, especially for those who were trying to get off of smoking. So of course, with this insane list of positives, you might be thinking the Premier's success was made in the shade. Well, it wasn't actually. Smokers hated the product and its foul stench. Non-smokers, of course, didn't want it in the first place. It was left to the few who simply thought it might be a nifty thing to try out. The company began to make losses on the product, and it was pulled from the shelves only 4 months after its launch. What a failure that was. You'd think the company would shut the cabinet door on the product and never return to it after this, except they didn't. They did the exact opposite, actually. In contrast to the decades prior, by the 90s, smoking had really become something people thought badly of. It felt like every day some random corporate doctor would come out with a new study on why nicotine rots the brain. With this new fervor of fear, Reynolds saw their chance to try out their disaster of a square yet again. In 1996, they would pour a whopping $125 million on research and development. This time, however, they left behind the legacy of the Premier and instead renamed it Eclipse. This product worked by letting charcoal heat the tobacco inside of the roll, allowing the smoker to release a tobacco/nicotine vapor, letting out roughly 10% the amount of smoke a normal cigarette let out. It was certainly no Premier, but it did the job without the smell. However, there's no such thing as a free lunch, especially in the world of nicotine. The smoker may have exhaled less smoke, but what they inhaled was far worse. With higher rates of toxins found in the product, especially when it got hot on the tip, the Eclipse cigar's outlook began to look bad. Every health organization from Boston to Las Vegas blew their lid at this new product. Their sketchy marketing led to the American Lung Association and the Campaign for Tobacco-Free Kids to get involved. There was no FDA oversight or regulation on Eclipse cigarettes, leading to a new wave of marketing attacks by these groups. And as for the Eclipse's medical defense, well, turns out the croakers researching the product were being paid off by the company to promote it as safe and healthy. The nail in the coffin for Eclipse was when medical analysts began to release damning evidence in regards to the dangers of using the product, with the most shocking report being the fact that glass fibers were found in the product. In fact, 99% of the cigarettes being sold contained glass fibers in the filters. Every time someone took a smoke, they weren't just inhaling CO2, but also glass. The new product was pulled just as quickly yet again, falling for the final time. the market would never see a smokeless cigarette again. Forget the health concerns and medical issues, the biggest reason the product died is because consumers saw no purpose in it. You either smoke a cigarette or you don't. There's no in-between. And no matter how hard the company tried to pose their product as this magical median between the two extremes, people saw through it. Just like a bowl of reheated macaroni, their second try would yield even worse results, and the legacy of the premier cigar would forever be seen as one of the biggest product failures in all of corporate history.